प्रीतम कुमार सर एंड ऑल लर्नेड फैकल्टी मेंबर ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ गवर्नमेंट इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज वैशाली आई वेलकम प्रीतम सर एंड आई वुड लाइक टू प्रेजेंट माय सिंसियर थैंक्स एंड ग्रेटिट्यूड टू सर फॉर एक्सेप्टिंग द इनविटेशन फ्रॉम जीईसी वैशाली एंड शेयरिंग हिज प्रीशियस टाइम टू अस. थैंक यू सर. ऑन दिस आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट रेस्पेक्टेड प्रिंसिपल सर टू काइंडली इन्वाइट प्रीतम सर विथ फ्यू वर्ड्स सो दैट सर कैन डिलीवर द वर्ड. थैंक यू सर. प्रिंसिपल सर.
Thank you, Mr. Vivek Upadhyay, and good morning to all of you. Our resource person of today's webinar, Dr. Pritam Kumarji, Associate Professor, IIT Patna. Organizer and convener of this webinar, Professor Vivek Upadhyay, is HOD of Department of Electrical Engineering as well as Electrical and Electronics Engineering. Faculty Coordinator, Professor Amit Abhishek, he is also Assistant Professor in the Department of A student coordinator, Vinish Bhaskar, Bhanu Srivastav, Adarsh Kumar, and Kansha Singh. Faculty members and dear students, a very warm welcome to all of you in this national level webinar on 5G challenges and enabling technology. So today's speaker is Pritam sir, and let you know that Pritam sir is associate professor in IIT Patna, and the department has been taking his expertise and advantages since long time, whether it is in formulation of our new syllabus or any policy making subject. He is frequently invited by my director as well as additional chief secretary, and he has been contributing a lot in improvement of the quality technical education state of Bihar. So welcome you sir again in this webinar. All of us know that India is focused on a digital agenda to transform the country, connecting its remotest corners so that even people at the bottom level can reap the benefits of digital inclusion. So there is a lot of emphasis on positioning the country as a global hub for manufacturing as part of the government's Make in India campaign. In this context, 5G and the Internet of Things are going to play a very critical and pivotal role, as it will enable a connected digital society and act as a core foundation of the fourth industrial revolution, as 5G is going to revolutionize the whole industries. 5G, the future of connectivity, is going to unlock the future potential of new industries, applications, and innovation in all fields, whether it is the advanced healthcare sector or education sector, smart agriculture sector, business, transportation, to enhance capabilities to respond to issues of public safety and overall the socio-economic growth of the nation in every corner of the country. These developments certainly will help us to establish and foster a cleaner, safer, and more sustainable society for current and future generation. In fact, no person, no industry, and no country will be left untouched by the benefit of this 5G future. As new 5G enabled services and applications are realized, new jobs will be created, and it will require certainly a talent, upskilled and reskilled persons at large scale. So it is going to open a very large opportunities in employment also. Overall, it has potential to be the basis on which digital vision of our nation can be realized. Now, with all my good wishes for the success of this webinar, we are honored to invite our chief guest and the resource person, Dr. Pritam Kumar Sarji, to shed light on the topic 5G challenges and enabling technology with a very warm welcome. And once again, I extend my hearty welcome to all participants. Thank you. And now over to Pritam sir. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Was it audible?
Yes, sir. Your voice is very audible, sir.
Okay. So let us start. I have invited Dr. Pritam sir to.
Sir is here, but his mic is also open. But I think sir is listening to us. Sir, Pritam sir, are you able to hear us, sir? Hello, Pritam sir. विद्यानंद सर आप ज्वाइन कर से आप क्या कहते हैं प्रेजेंट करके मत ज्वाइन कीजिए, आप ज्वाइन से ज्वाइन कीजिए तो सामने वाला प्रेजेंट नहीं कर पाएगा सर। विद्यानंद सर आप लेफ्ट होके तब जो है प्रेजेंट पे क्लिक मत की नहीं कीजिएगा, ज्वाइन पे क्लिक कीजिएगा। मैं तो सर थैंक यू विनीश। विनीश वेदर वी आर ऑनलाइन और नॉट बेटा।
सर वी आर ऑनलाइन सर।
ओके ओके तो सर भी आ गए। प्रीतम सर आए थे बट कुछ। गुड मॉर्निंग गुप्ता सर। सर आपका
विवेक विवेक विवेक
यस सर यस सर यस सर गुड मॉर्निंग सर। गुड मॉर्निंग प्रीतम सर।
नाउ आई एम ऑडिबल।
यस सर यू आर क्लियरली ऑडिबल सर।
राइट राइट ग्रेट ग्रेट देयर वाज सम इशू विद द कनेक्शन। So I am thankful to Dr. Anand Kumar sir and Government Engineering College Vaishali for inviting me, and it is my privilege to deliver a talk on 5G, and I hope this 1 hour talk will give you some idea about this cutting edge technology, which is very relevant as pointed out by Dr. Anand Kumar sir, that it is really important. We missed India missed 3G and 4G initiative, but in 5G, in fact, government is also taking a lot of interest. In fact, they have made a 5G core committee, which is trying to take lead and which trying to take the India's perspective heard at the international level. So we are participating in lots of standardization activities in 5G. And there is a consortium of so many institutes in India and industry which are working on standardizing the 5G technologies. So this is a very apt and very timely discussion on 5G, and I hope that I will be able to convey some important ideas about 5G, the challenges and the enabling technologies. Vivek, I think I'm clear. I'm audible.
Yes, sir, you are clearly audible, sir.
Let me share my presentation and tell me whether it is visible, right?
Okay, sir.
Is it visible, Vivek?
Yes, sir. Sir, your screen is visible, sir.
Okay, thank you, thank you. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir. Screen is visible, okay. But presentation is coming right now, sir.
It's coming now?
No, sir. It will come, sir. It will come.
Now tell me.
No, sir, only screen is visible, and 5G GEC Vaishali people, that list is visible, sir, but presentation is not opening, sir.
I don't know what is happening then. Now tell me.
No, sir, again the same.
Let me reconnect them, okay?
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
I don't know why it is not visible. I am sharing it.
Hey, band karo.
Now tell me, Vivek.
Yes, sir. Now it is visible.
Slide is visible.
Presentation is visible, sir. Yes, sir. Slide is visible.
Now I am scrolling. Just say, second slide is visible.
Yes, sir. Second slide outline is visible, sir.
Very good. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
So let us start this. And sorry for the initial disturbance. So the content of the talk. Vivek, if you find somewhere problem in this slides and all, please remind me, right?
Okay, sir. Okay, sure, sir.
Okay. So outline will be initially I will give you a brief introduction about this 5G, and because 5G has been developed concerning the development earlier, like in 3G and 4G. So next I will discuss about LTE and 4G. Because 4G is one of the path through which the 5G has been evolved. Then I will discuss about the requirements of 5G, then challenges and facilitators. And there are two tracks. One is evolution track and new radio access track. And then some of the R&D technology areas where some of the faculty members, students will be interested to work. That's new wave for millimeter wave, massive MIMO, headnet, cognitive radio, and D2D communication. And finally, I will conclude and give some references. So this is the first slide, and here what I'm trying to show is that. So this slide is visible, Vivek?
Yes, sir. Slide is visible, sir. Introduction is.
Thank you. Sir. Introduction. Thanks. So just give a few seconds to this slide and observe that there are so many technologies I have put on the one graph. So on the x-axis we have data rate, and on y-axis we have mobility, that how speed, how fast the mobile is moving, as well as the coverage area, right? So coverage is divided into two parts. One is indoor and outdoor. Indoor, we fix two things, that's fixed one, and the second is the pedestrian. And the outdoor, we have fixed pedestrian and the vehicular, right? So if you see that there is a red straight line curve, linear curve that specifies about spectral efficiency. So let me tell you what spectral efficiency is. Spectral efficiency is very important because it tells us that in one unit bandwidth or in one hertz, how many data you are able to transmit, right? And we know that the spectrum is a scarce resource, and we want to transmit as many information as possible in a unit bandwidth, a unit spectrum. So if we are moving from 1G to 4G, we see that the spectral efficiency is increasing linearly. And then we have two circles. One is for circuit switched, and other is the packet switched, that is the green one. So these are two ways we give the connection to the two mobile subscribers. And the first one is the circuit switched, where we give the dedicated resources for the connection to establish. So suppose the typical example is your landline telephone, where we are getting the wired connection to your premises, to your office. And from there, it is going through the telephone exchange, through the coaxial cable, and everything is, and even for remote places, you can go for microwave. So a dedicated resource is established before we start our conversation. So this is a dedicated resource in circuit switch. But in packet switch, we are not giving a dedicated resource. Suppose, for example, you are moving on a highway. So that highway is meant for everyone. So everybody can come, and you can feel there will be a lot of traffic on the road. So you will try to find out your own way to reach to the destination. And there may be stoppage, red light signals and all. So packet switching is basically not a dedicated connection. It is the a connection which is being shared by many users, and finally we reach to our destination, like in a highway. We reach to our destination, although there is traffic jam, there may be blockage somewhere, but finally we reach to the destination. So it is best effort service. Right, so we try to get to the destination, but there is no dedicated way. But in circuit switching, you will have a complete full stretch of the road, highway dedicated to you only. So you can understand that circuit switch is a costly affair, and we cannot afford when there are a lot of users, when there are a lot of data on the channel. So, but circuit switch was very predominant up to 3G standard, right? To 1G and 2G was totally on circuit switching. But 2.5G and 3G, they were both hybrid mode, circuit switch and packet switch. And beyond 3G, that is 3.5G, 3.7G and 4G and 5G, in fact, they all are on packet switching. That's why we say that this 5G and 4G, they all are based on IP networks. Because circuit switching is given by, packet switching is given by on the IP protocol. So internet protocol, so this is basically a packet switch network. This one important point from this plot graph. And apart from this, generations 1G to 4G, there are other standards also, like Wi-Fi, then Bluetooth, then WiMAX, which are predominantly in the unlicensed band. They are not in this particular standard, but there is standard in own, like Bluetooth is 802.15, Wi-Fi 802.11, similarly WiMAX is 802.16. These all are standards, and they are independent standards from the 4G or 3G, and they are also giving services to on a limited scale. So when you are moving from 1G to 4G, what generally we all understand that there will be improvement in different aspects of services like mobility. So even in 4G, if you are moving on a very high speed train at 200 km per hour, or even if you are moving in an aeroplane, you may get this connection. But earlier, getting connection connections and very high speed vehicles like bullet trains and all was not possible. So when we are moving from 1G to 4G, we are getting services even at high mobility. We are getting enhanced coverage. The data rate is increasing and quality of service. Means if you all know that 4G gives better service compared to 2G and 1G and 3G. So these three points, 1G and 2G are circuit switch. We have just observed 2.5G to 3G. They are both in hybrid mode, both are circuit and packet switched. And 3.5G to 5G, they are totally exclusively packet switched, right? So you should know the difference between circuit switch and packet switch, and that I already have discussed. And all the evolving generations are using licensed spectrum, right? All these, because 3G and 4G, they are in licensed spectrum. They cannot work on unlicensed spectrum. But Wi-Fi, they are using unlicensed spectrum. Bluetooth and WiMAX, they are all using unlicensed spectrum, right? That's why they Wi-Fi and Bluetooth are very common nowadays, and they are very cheap. We don't have to pay a lot of money for that, and most of places is free of cost. So before moving to 5G, let us see that what are the building blocks. These are the building blocks which pave the way for 5G. So first I will discuss this 2G wireless cellular standards, because it is still very predominant in speech communication, voice communication, like this Airtel and was a core technology till 3G, but we'll see that from when we move from 3G, we have to leave the CDMA. So the point is that GSM and IS-95, which is 2G standard, are based for voice communication rate and of around 10 kbps, and they can give you data rate up to 10 kbps. But that was not sufficient. We know that 10 kbps is not good enough for data communication. So this general packet radio services, GPRS, all of you are using right now, and enhanced data for GSM evaluation, that is EDGE, were proposed with a speed in the range of 100 kbps to provide low speed internet, email, etc. to users with mobile devices. So that why we need 2.5G? Well, there was 2G, which is optimized for speech communication, voice communication, but there was a need felt where we need that even if we are moving, we should be able to browse the internet, right? And we should get this low data rate services. So 2.5G was developed based on that. And the two important key standards for 2.5G are GPRS and EDGE, which were able to GPRS was able to support 50 kbps and EDGE was able to support 200 kbps. But at the end of 2000, the year between 1995 to 2000, we start feeling that we need more data. We need to get the internet, seamless internet services. We should be able to browse the internet, right? And we should get this video telephony and video conferencing. The need was felt. So that the last point is that the increasing demand for higher data rates led to the development of the 3G cellular standard. So that's why 3G was developed around 2000, mostly predominantly 3G was developed between 2000 to 2005. So 3G has again two types of generation, one is 3G, another is 3.5G. So 3G was based on, there are two standards, one is WCDMA and UMTS. So they are, these two terms are used interchangeably, and CDMA 2000. And you can observe that WCDMA and CDMA 2000 were able to support a data rate of 384 kbps. But still this 384 kbps was not enough to support video call or video conferencing. So we start working on that, and I remember that around 2005, between 2005 to 2010, we were able to get this 3.5 generation standards, that is HSDPA, high speed downlink packet access, and HSUPA's high speed uplink packet access. So they were developed and they were able to support 5 to 30 Mbps. Similarly, we have this 1X EVDO division A and B. They were able to support 5 to 30 Mbps. Here, I would like to tell you that for video call or video conferencing, we need minimum of 10 Mbps, right? Minimum of 10 Mbps is required. So you can observe that 3G is not able to give you video calling or video services. Basically, it is basically 3.5G and 3.5G 2 standard, that is HSDPA and 1SE video. So sometimes you can observe on your mobile that these services are visible at the top of your mobile handset. And due to this HSDPA and EVDO, you are able to get this video telephony, video calling, WhatsApp call, and everything. Because for this type of video calling, we need a data rate of 10 Mbps. But still, even if we got this 3.5G, we are not able to get this high definition TV. Video gaming, all these things were not possible with 3.5G. And then from 2010 onwards, we start working on that, and we thought that we have to move on, and finally we got 4G. So 4G was meant to increase the data rate significantly, and you can observe that the first 4G standard, that is LTE, was able to support a data rate of 100 to 200 Mbps with the different configurations. But a minimum LTE can ensure you 100 Mbps. And that was the reason that we got enhanced services in 4G. And all the companies in India and around the globe, they started implementing 4G technologies. So, but another WiMAX. WiMAX is also important technology, but it was evolved by independent body. And that also promised 100 Mbps, but somehow WiMAX was not very popular because LTE was adopted in so many standards and so many countries start implementing LTE. So WiMAX has somehow, they lost the race, and now it has very limited applications. And it further evolved as LTE advanced, where we thought that we'll get a speed of greater than 1 Gbps. But LTE advanced is still, it is not standardized. It is still in a development phase. And we thought that let us move to a new paradigm, new evolution of wireless services, wireless standard, that is 5G, right? So let us now summarize that. This is a cellular service progression. In this slide, I'm trying to tell you the summary of what we have discussed in previous 3-4 slides. So we have discussed that the generation 2 to 2.75G, they are able to give you data rate of 10 to 100 Kbps. And that was mostly meant for voice, low rate data services. Then came the regime of third generation, that is 3 to 3.5G. And you can see that they are able to give you data rate from 300 Kbps to 30 Mbps. And as we are able to get more than 10 Mbps services, in addition to voice and data, we are able to get this video calling and video conferencing. So for video calling and video conferencing, 3 to 3.5G is enough, good enough. We don't require anything more than that. But again, there is a enhancement in the technology, and 4G came, and we are able to give a data rate of 100 to 200 Mbps, and that it is possible to go for online gaming. So online gaming is very popular nowadays. And we are able to get the full HDTV streaming on our mobile handset. We are able to view the news channels. We are able to do this video streaming. So this all were done till 4G. But we will learn that what was there in 4G and what made it possible. Why 4G was able to be seen from 30 Mbps and in third generation, 3.5 generation, we are moving to 100 Mbps. So almost it is an increase of, 3 to 5 times of speed. So you can imagine that because getting 30 Mbps was not so easy, right? So CDMA technology was involved to give you 30 Mbps, but point is that how we move from 30 Mbps to 100 Mbps? What was the main technology which made it possible to get 100 Mbps over the air? So understanding of this technology is very important. What are the technologies which make this 4G possible, right? So this is a reality now. We can get a speed of 100 Mbps. But what are the technologies? Because these technologies are the building blocks of 5G. So next few slides, I think I will discussing on the core technologies of 4G. Right. So now we'll discuss LTE is basically 4G. LTE is a standard. LTE is a generation and 4G is a standard. So now you can observe that in November 2004, 3GPP, this is the standardization body, third generation partnership project, began a project to define the long-term evolution of universal mobile telecommunication system cellular technology. So basically this is a 4G technique, and the aim was to provide higher performance, backward compatible. Always keep in mind that 4G technologies are backward compatible to 3G and 2G technologies. It is not like that if you are using a 4G handset, suppose you are not able to get 4G services, you will be able to get the 3G and 2G services. That is always backward compatible. This is one of the beauty of 4G. And so many times we are not able to go to 4G services due to so many reasons, but you will be able to get this seamless connections using this 2G, 3G and 2G services with the same mobile handset. So this is a next generation mobile broadband technology, promises data rates of 100 Mbps based on UMTS technology. Then it is very important point. The last point is this is optimized for all IP traffic. Already I have discussed in the second slide that this 4G is based on IP, internet protocol. It is a packet switching. It is a data communication, right? Even if you are using a WhatsApp call, it is based, it is not a circuit switch, it is using data. So your whole transmission is break into different packet, and that packet is being transmitted, and they may follow different paths. They may follow different paths to reach the destination. So there is a challenge at the receiver to orient this packet so that you will get the seamless connection. So these are the advantages of 4G, that is LTE, and this all we know that. So this gives you high network throughput, low latency, plug and play architecture. So just you need to have this 4G SIM and you'll get the services, low operating cost, all IP network, simplified upgrade path from 3G networks. So we try to see that from when we are moving from 3G to 4G, the path should be simplified. So these are the advantages for the network operators, for end users like us. This is faster data downloads. In 4G, you see that you can get a very fast download, uploads, improved response for applications, and improved end user experience. So 4G services are quite good compared to 3G and 2G. Now, this is very important, very, very important slide for people like us who are doing a lot of R&Ds, a lot of research. So these are the major LTE technologies. The first one is very important, that it uses orthogonal frequency division multiplexing for downlink, right? So this 4G uses OFDM for the downlink. And I will discuss more about this OFDM, because I wish that all of you understand OFDM very clearly, particularly sir, the third and final.
Sir, slide is third slide is showing, sir. Slide is not.
Which slide?
The third slide is showing on the screen.
Right now, you are seeing which slide?
Third, sir. Slide number three, sir. Introduction, evolution to wireless technology.
My God, you should have told me, na, bhai. After this, you are not seeing? This third is visible?
Oh, yes, yes, third is visible.
Vivek.
Third is visible. Yes, sir, third is visible, sir.
Now,
third slide is visible. Now fourth is visible. Fourth is visible, sir.
My, you should have... Arre Baba, I have moved to slide 11. You should have told me.
We thought that...
This is the fourth slide?
Yes, sir, yes, sir. This is
no, arre, I thought... So this is the problem with the online platform, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Because we the listener and the speaker, they become passive, right? This is the fourth slide.
Yes, sir.
Already I have discussed, right? This is all about 1G, 2G, 1G and 2G are circuit switch. 2.5G and 3G are both circuit and packet switch.
Yes, yes.
And 3.5G to 5G, they are packet switch, right? And this is about this slide is visible.
Yes, sir. This slide is visible, sir. 2G, 2G, 2.5G. Yes, sir. Yes.
So I should not keep on the full screen mode, right? I should leave on the slide mode. So you can observe here that 2G is able to, the 2G is GSM and IS-95.
Yes,
and they're able
yes,
to give it 10 kbps only.
Yes,
but
sir,
when
yes,
we talk about GPRS, all of you, we are using GPRS and Edge. That is a 2.5G standard. and they are able to give you a data rate of 50 kbps and 200 kbps. So we'll get a data services. We are able to go for internet, low speed internet, email, etc. Is possible with due to this edge and GPRS, right?
Yes, sir.
Then we move to 3G, and 3G has two generation, 3G and 3.5G. 3G is able to give you 384 kbps, and 3.5G, it has two standards, HSDPA and HSVPN 1SE video. They're able to give you 5 to 30 mbps. And for video calling and video conferencing, we require a speed of 10 mbps. So this video calling, WhatsApp calling, video conferencing is possible only due to 3.5G technology. 3G technology is not able to give you this video calling, right? Video conferencing, this is 3.5G. And the two standards are HSDPA, high-speed downlink packet access, HSUPA, you miss uplink. High-speed uplink packet access and 1SE video, they are able to give you services of 5 to 30 mbps, right? And due to that only, we are able to get this video calling and video conferencing. So when we move to 4G. 4G has three standards, LTE, WiMAX, LTE Advanced. And you can observe that 4G is able to give you data rate of 100 to 200 mbps. And then finally, we came to service program progression. So 2 to 2.75G, they are meant for voice and low rate data, but 3 to 3.5G, from 300 kbps, 30 mbps, that's for voice, data. You can see that video calling and video conferencing is not possible.
Yes.
And 4G, we can go for high HDTV and online gaming, right? Then we move to this LTE. LTE was started in 2004. And finally, we move to this advantage of LTE. And now we are talking about a very important slide, that is major LTE technologies. Vivek?
Yes. Yes, sir.
LTE slide is visible, right?
Okay, yes, sir. Good. Visible, sir.
So this LTE technology is very important. LTE, the technologies which made it possible to transmit at 100 Mbps compared to 3G. 3G and 3.5G is basically based on CDMA, on OFDM, and OFDM is one of the important techniques which made us transmit at 100 Mbps. Very, very important. Very, very important. And I'll discuss more in detail about OFDM in next few slides. But that was the downlink, because downlink we need more speed. So OFDM was used for downlink. But for uplink, we are using a single carrier frequency division multiplexing, that SCFDM is used for uplink. Why is OFDM is not used for uplink? I'm leaving this question to all of you. Just find out why OFDM is very good technology. It can provide you 100 Mbps in the downlink, but in uplink there is some issue. So we are using a variant of OFDM, that is SCFDMA in the uplink. The third point is very important, where we are talking about multiple input, multiple output for enhanced throughput. You can observe that this mobile handsets, what we are getting in 4G, they have multiple antennas. There is not a single antenna. Although antenna is not visible, that is because that is in size of millimeter, but the mobile handset has multiple antennas. And you can observe this base station, that is the BTS towers, where they have multiple receive antennas or transmit antennas. So when we have this multiple receive and transmit antennas, we say that that technology is MIMO, right? So we have multiple transmitter and multiple receiver. Another important point is reduced power consumption. We have to design a technology which requires less power. And in that line, we have the last point, is that more the power is consumed with the RF power amplifier. So higher RF power amplifier efficiency. If the power amplifier efficiency is higher, then you can ensure less battery power used by handsets. Because handsets, what we are using is a portable device. So we want that it should, the power amplifier, whatever you are using, they should be efficient so that the battery life is longer. So these are the major LTE related technologies which are implemented in 4G. Now, before moving to this OFDM, I want to tell you about the challenges of wireless communication. I assume that there are a lot of BTEC students, third and final year, and faculties who are planning to do research. So understanding of wireless channel is very important. And there are two challenges in high-speed communication over wireless channel. These two challenges are inter-symbol interference and frequency selective channel, right? These are two challenges on high-speed communication over wireless channels. And whatever technologies we are developing, whether in 4G and 5G, are mostly to take care of these two wireless challenges, right? So let us see what are these two challenges. And as you can observe that the BTS tower is there, and BTS is transmitting signal, and we have a receiver, mobile receiver, and whenever a BTS is transmitting the signal, it is not following a single path because it's an antenna and it is radiating the signal in all the direction. So the received signal and the receiver will follow different paths, right? There will be direct path, there will be one path reflected from a moving vehicle, and one path will be reflected from a high-rise building. So what will happen that the received signal will have multiple copies of the same transmitted signal, and this will lead to interference. And that interference is called inter-symbol interference, right? So white is the output signal at the mobile handset. Then we have ST is the input signal from the transmitter. STM is the delayed signal, and NT is the noise signal, right? And as you can observe at the bottom of the slide, that the signal received by direct path, that will be the fastest path. This signal will receive, but at the same time, after some time, it will receive the replica of the received signal via a indirect path, longer path, maybe from the building or moving vehicle. So you will observe that they are not in time, and they are not time aligned. There will be time delay because the second path is following a longer path, so they will take more time to reach the receiver. So they are not time aligned. So the signal of this delayed path will act as an interference, and that interference is called ISI. I have shown you that ISI is this one, so inter-symbol interference, and we have to take care of that. To take care of the inter-symbol interference, we design a receiver, equalizer. So equalizers are used to take care of this inter-symbol interference. And to just mathematically understand what equalizer is doing, is that because the received signal y of t is what? The direct signal s of t plus beta into st minus f, that is the delayed signal. Beta is the attenuation, because the longer path will be attenuated more. And what we have done, we have tried to find the transfer function. We'll take the Fourier transform of this. So HCF is basically 1 plus beta E minus J 2 pi FM. So what the equalizer is doing at the receiver, equalizer is basically the inverse of the channel response, 1 by HCF. So if we multiply 1 by HCF, if we design a filter at the receiver, which is inverse of the channel, so this will take care of your inter-symbol interference. This is a very important concept, right? So I request all the listeners to just try to go through some standard books on wireless communication and try to understand that what is inter-symbol interference is very important, very critical for the success of 5G, and try to see that what is inter-symbol interference and how we are taking care of by using the equalizer. Second challenge is frequency selective fading channel. Now what will happen that, because there are multiple paths, so if you're transmitting a signal, you just see that two signals. So we are transmitting single carrier signal, right? We are transmitting a signal, a clean pulse we are transmitting, and there is multipath. And due to this multipath, what is happening is that the clean signal is distorted. We are not at the receiver. Due to this multipath, we are not able to get the clean received signal. It is distorted, and there will be multiple deep fades, right? You see that deep fades I am showing you. And these deep fades will make the signal received with error. Deep fades, because your signal is distorted, it is not a clean signal, the signal power level is changing, so you will not be able to receive the signal. There will be error in the received signal, right? So one solution everybody can think that I've written in the bottom, the red line, red color, that it may be useless for increasing transmission power. You may think that it will increase the transmission power, right? But transmission power is not going to help you, because this deep weights is so high, is so severe, that your signal will be lost. That's why when you are talking on a mobile handset, you can observe that suddenly you lose. Suddenly you feel that there is no transmission, you are not receiving anything. right? I'm expressing a lot these days. You might have also observed a conversation is going on. Suddenly you feel that there is no incoming speech signal because the signal has gone to the deep field and you have lost the signal, right? So these are two challenges. And we'll see that how these two challenges are taken care of in 4G. If I am able to convey you these things, then the understanding of 5G will be easier. Now, to take these challenges off, these two challenges, we go for a technique called orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, right? So you have just observed in the previous slide that if you're transmitting a single carrier signal, this multipath distortion will be there, frequency distortion will be there. We are trying to avoid this. We want to see that how we should avoid deep fades. Deep fade means what? Your signal strength will go down by 20 dB, 30 dB, 40 dB. If the signal strength and the receiver is down by that much amount, 20 dB, more than 20 dB, you will not be able to see, you will not be able to receive anything. So we have to think for a methodology where we are able to avoid this distorted received signal, or we are able to avoid this deep fades. And that technique is called orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. Here what we are doing, we are not transmitting a single carrier like CDMA. Why CDMA is not used in 4G is that CDMA is a single carrier technique. And whenever you transmit a single carrier signal at high speed at 100 Mbps, suppose we have 4G, we are transmitting at 50 Mbps, leave about 100 Mbps. Up to 30 Mbps is fine, but when transmitting at 50 Mbps, 80 Mbps, 100 Mbps, the same signal will have multiple deep fades. So one solution is that we should not transmit CDMA, which is single carrier technique. We'll transmit multiple carriers, and we will see that all these carriers are orthogonal. That's why we are terming this frequency division multiplexing, that we are transmitting multiple frequencies, right? And at the same time, they are orthogonal. That's why the first line, OFDM is orthogonal FDM. What is FDM? Frequency division multiplexing, but is an orthogonal FDM. So carrier centers are put on orthogonal frequencies. Now, what do we mean by orthogonality? Why it is called orthogonal? You just see that we are transmitting, see the diagram at the bottom, we are transmitting seven frequencies, F1 to F7. And the center of all the carriers, whenever the F1 has the maximum value, all other signals have zero value, right? It means that whenever the first carrier is at the maximum, the remaining carriers are at the minimum. So there is no interference, because whenever we take a decision about a transmission, whether it's a one and zero, we are sampling at the middle of the carrier. And whatever value you are getting, based on that, we take a decision about whether it's a transmitted one or zero. And whenever we are taking this decision, at that time, all other carriers have zero value, zero crossing. They have zero crossing. So that's why the term orthogonality basically means what? The peak of each signal coincides with trough of other signals. Whenever it is peak, trough of other signals are there. Now you can observe from the diagram that to make these signals orthogonal, right, the spacing should be 1 by TS, right? See, the first carrier peak and second carrier peak, right, the difference between these two carriers, F1 minus F2, should be 1 by TS. What is TS? TS is the symbol time. Whatever you are transmitting on the wireless channel, you are transmitting ones and zeros, right? So they make a symbol. So that symbol time, because next transmission will be on F2. If you're transmitting one bit at F1, next bit will be at the F2. Third bit will be at the F3, right? So these bits, whatever bits you are transmitting, right, they are transmitted at different carriers, and these carriers should be orthogonal says us that to make them orthogonal, the difference between these two carriers should be the symbol 1 by the T symbol. right? It will be more clear when we move further, right? Now, you must have heard about a technique called FDMA. FDMA also is frequency division in multiple access, right? Where we have, so if you see the first diagram, this is called FDM, frequency division multiplexing. What we are multiplexing, what we are doing, we are transmitting so many signals at the same time. But what we are doing, we are giving a guard band. We are not transmitting any signal between two frequency bands. We are not transmitting any signal between two frequency bands. So this is called frequency bands. These are frequency bands, and these bands are multiplexed. But what we are doing in OFDM, see, OFDM, we are allowing them to overlap. Let them overlap. There is no issue. But as they are orthogonal, they will not interfere. So initially, we are able to transmit only three users. We are able to only support three users or three data. Now we are able to support five users or five data at the same time. So that's why OFDM is spectrally efficient. Right? That's why the next question comes. Why OFDM in 4G? Why we are using OFDM in 4G? The two important observations what we made in the previous slides are that high data rate symbols are converted into low data rate by serial to parallel converters to cope with inter-symbol interference. We'll see that now we have multiple subcarriers. Now on each subcarrier, we can transmit different datas. So a high data rate, we can convert from serial to parallel into multiple low data rate, and we can transmit over multiple subcarriers. That is what we are doing in OFDM. We'll show it in the next slide. And it is better than a single carrier over feeding channel. We'll try to answer these questions in next few slides. What the first point is that high data symbols are converted into low data rate by serial to parallel converters to cope with inter-symbol interference. The first problem we have shown that inter-symbol interference is why? Because these multipath signals, we are interfering with each other. This is one thing. Second thing is the frequency selective fading, because these multipath signals are being added at different angles, right? They are being added at different angles. Sometimes they will add constructively, sometimes they will subtract it because these multipath signals, all these multipath signals will have different attenuation and different phase. If they are in the same phase, they will add up. If they are in totally phase opposite, they will subtract. If they are with some angle, the signal strength will be less. So what is happening that this we are getting this multipath distortion. So these all are able to take care by better than single carrier. If you are transmitting single carrier like CDMA, these two problems will be very significant, right? So the first problem is inter-symbol interference, that we'll see that why it is coming, because we have seen that this is transmitted and this is a receiver, right? So there is a delay. Whenever you are transmitting some signal, 1010 we're transmitting, we are receiving 1010, but with delay tau. So this delay, this tau max, if this delay is more than TB, your bit duration, that is bit duration, this TB is bit duration, then inter-symbol interference occurs, right? For high data rate transmission, what will happen? TB will reduce. If you are transmitting a high data rate, the data rate is basically 1 by TB. So when you are transmitting at 100 Mbps in 4G, the TB is reduced, right? So TB is reduced means that inter-symbol interference will be more predominant. So we'll see that when we are moving to 4G, how we are able to take care with OFDM. This slide is very important. Just observe this slide very carefully. So left side, we are transmitting at a single carrier. Data rate is 4 bits per second. In 1 second, we are transmitting 4 bits. And these 4 bits I have denoted by different colors, right? So each color, each box colored, it corresponds to 1 bit, right? So we are in 1 second, we are transmitting 4 bit So the TB, the bit duration is 1/4 second, and we are transmitting at 4 bits per second. But in OFDM, what we are doing, we are converting this serial transmission to parallel transmission. So now we are transmitting parallelly. We are converting to serial to parallel, and now we are transmitting in parallel. And what we are doing, we are stretching the bits. We are, in 1 second, we are transmitting again 4 bits. Just see that. In one second, we are transmitting 4 bits. But the bit duration has increased. Earlier, the bit duration was 1/4 second. Now it is 1 second. Because whenever we increase the bit duration, all the multipath signal will come within the bit duration. Because for inter-symbol interference, the condition is that the multipath delay should be more than the bit duration. Then only it will appear in the next symbol. If it is coming within the symbol, your life is easier. Right? So by this serial to parallel conversion, and now what we'll do, all these four parallel transmissions will be transmitted on 4 orthogonal subcarriers. Right? Because now we have 4 bits to transmit in parallel. So what we need to do? We need to have 4 parallel subcarriers, and this should be orthogonal. And that is what we are doing in OFDM. Right? Now, so this slide is visible, Vivek?
It's visible, sir.
Let me go on a full slide mode, then it will be more clear. Then again, I will come back.
The slide is clear? Yes, sir.
Visible? Just see that, because we understand that in OFDM, we need multiple carriers. Like we have seen one of the examples, there are 7 subcarriers. To generate 7 subcarriers, carrier frequencies, simple is that, you have a data, convert to serial to parallel, and each data is transmitted over different subcarriers. So suppose we have N data, right? We have serially, we have made N data. Like we have seen 4 bits, suppose we have now N bits, N, capital N. So how many oscillators we need now? We need N oscillators. And that's why the first oscillator, that 0th oscillator to N minus 1 oscillators. And the EJ0, EJ2pi, these all are the oscillator frequencies. Right? Now, what was the problem with this implementation of this? That we need N oscillators. So problem is that we need bank of oscillators required. And because this is oscillators, and you know that designing oscillators is very tricky. If you design an oscillator at a given frequency, if the temperature changes, or after some few years, the oscillator frequency will change, right? It will slip slightly. So that's why the second line is very hard to maintain frequency separation delta F. Because this delta F will change with temperature, with aging. And we know that to maintain the orthogonality between different subcarriers, this delta F should be equal to 1/TB or TS. That's why this configuration is not possible. Very interesting point is that OFDM was proposed in 1970 itself for this cable TV transmission. But at the time, from 1970, it took almost 35 years in 2010 or 2005 when we felt that OFDM is a very good technique. But why OFDM was not so popular from 1970 to 2005? The reason is this only, because you need to have multiple oscillators, and designing, keeping oscillator frequencies constant is very difficult. So this was not possible. So what we did? Same thing, data, then serial to parallel, and then in place of oscillators, what we are using? We are using IFFT.
21st slide is showing, sir. Slide is not moving.
Is it visible now?
Sir, 21st slide is showing, sir.
21st.
Okay, yes.
So what you observe that ये विजिबल है, क्रॉस साइन आया है?
यस सर, इट इज विजिबल है सर.
आर यू एबल टू सी दिस एंड पॉइंट आईएफटी? गुड.
यस सर, एंड पॉइंट आईएफटी इज विजिबल.
यस. नाउ सो व्हाट वी आर डूइंग नाउ इज दैट इन प्लेस ऑफ दिस एन ऑसिलेटर्स, फिजिकल ऑसिलेटर्स, we are replacing with endpoint IFT. How many of you know about DFT, discrete Fourier transform, fast Fourier transform, right? So definitely we have that you must have read in your BTech days or in the final year or third year students, they must know that it is being taught in DSP subject called distance signal processing. And this is a very important technique where with the discrete signals, we have a discrete signals because in digital communication or in 4G and 5G, we are transmitting discrete signals, right? Digital communication, we are transmitting ones and zeros. So we have signal in discrete form. And when we have a signal in discrete form, you can convert this discrete signal using this Fourier transform. That's called discrete Fourier transform. And that discrete Fourier transform basically gives you orthogonal orthogonality between different transmitted bits. So if you are transmitting 10 bits and if you take the FFT of that or DFT of that, these all 10 bits are now orthogonal, right? If you take this FFT of that, they will become orthogonal, right? They will not overlap when you are transmitting. And to implement this DFT, practically we are using a technique called FFT, fast Fourier transfer. So fast Fourier transfer are used to take care of this DFT. So that's why this oscillators can be replaced by IFFT at the transmitter and FFT at the receiver. That's why I have given you the title of this one. Sorry. Dikh raha hai ye?
Yes, sir. 21st
slide is visible?
Right. Yes, sir, it is visible.
So that's why I have given the title OFDM transmitter. So IFT is used as a transmitter and FFT is used as a receiver to implement this bank of oscillators. And that was the reason that if we start, because when we implemented this oscillators bank with FFT and IFT, that is discrete Fourier transform and inverse discrete Fourier transform, then this OFDM started taking momentum and OFDM become very popular. And OFDM is a technology for 4G as well as for 5G, for your kind information. OFDM is still considered for 5G. And the main reason is that why OFDM is so popular, because OFDM was proposed in 1970, but due to this bank of oscillators, it was difficult to maintain this orthogonality. So due to the advancement in DSP, we are able to, so that this, when we take this discrete signal, if you take the Fourier transform of that, then they are orthogonal to each other, and we use that concept, and then OFDM become popular, and that's why the reason that we have 4G right now, and we'll have 5G in near future, right? Because OFDM is able to take care of your inter-symbol interference. OFDM takes care of the very severe problems. The CDM, the problem was that ISI was too much, inter-symbol interference was too much, right? Inter-symbol interference was too much because when you are transmitting a high data rate, your bit rate reduces, right? Because bit rate is what? Bit rate is 1 by TB, where TB is the bit duration. So if you're transmitting from 10 Mbps to 100 Mbps, so bit rate, the bit period will be reduced by how much time? It will be reduced by 0.01 time. Like what? So earlier the bit period was, suppose, so 10 Mbps were transmitting. If you're transmitting 100 Mbps, so the bit rate you have reduced by 0.1 times, right? So 10 Mbps you have TB, now you have 0.1 TB. So bit rate is reduced by 10 times. So whenever bit rate is reduced by 10 times, the inter-symbol interference due to this multipath, due to the delayed components, will be very severe. And that's why CDMA, that is signal carrier technology, was not feasible in 4G. Then we start working on this OFDM, and OFDM, fortunately, we implemented using this DFT and IFT using this DSP technologies, and OFDM become very popular, and we are able to implement this OFDM and we are able to take care of intersymbol interference. We are able to transmit. Now, what we are doing in OFDM, what we are doing, we are transmitting serial to parallel. And by making the serial to parallel conversion, we are increasing the bit period TB, right? What we are doing, we are increasing bit period, but we are transmitting in parallel. So bit rate is intact. Bit rate, we are not changing. Only thing is that we are transmitting in parallel, and due to this liberty that we are able to transmit in parallel, the bit duration has increased. And this increased bit duration will take care of the inter-symbol interference. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Why? If you have any question, you can ask me. I don't want to postpone this because understanding of OFDM is very important. If I am able to convey you the technology of OFDM, I will be much more happier. There is no need to go further, right? Tell me.
Sir, actually, we are keeping the questionnaire session in the last. We are collecting the question from the student.
You have students, BTEC students?
Yes, sir. Sir, we are having students on YouTube platform and Facebook platforms.
Okay,
and,
good, fine.
They are listening to me and we are collecting questions as well, sir. In the last, we will be having a questionnaire session, sir.
Okay, fine. So, I will be happy to answer questions on OFDM. OFDM is very important technique. And you can see that I have written in green color. So this, due to this OFDM, because from moving from FDM to OFDM, we see that spectral efficiency is increasing because in FDM, we are only transmitting, we are able to transmit 3 bits. But when we are going for OFDM, we are able to transmit 5 bits in the same frequency band. So spectral efficiency is increasing and it reduces inter-symbol interference by multipath because what we are doing in OFDM, we are transmitting serial to parallel. So we are not changing the data rate, but we are changing the bit duration. So it takes care of inter-symbol interference, and it is also good in case of frequency-selective channel. Frequency-fading channel, we'll see that how OFDM is able to take care of frequency-selective fading channel. Because what we are doing in OFDM, we are using cyclic prefix, and that cyclic prefix is able to take care of this frequency-selective fading narrow channel. So slide 22 is visible, Vivek?
Sir, visible, sir. Slide is visible. 22 is visible, sir.
Okay. Now, I'm showing you the big picture, right? And I'm happy that you are able to understand this picture. This is the OFDM, which is foundation for LTE and Wi-Fi. Even Wi-Fi is using OFDM. Good thing is that Wi-Fi is using OFDM. We all are using Wi-Fi, right? So just I'm giving the block of the transmitter, this OFDM transmitter. So so we have data, digital data. We are doing this coding and modulation. Coding and modulation is very important. Error control coding, source coding, and we are doing this modulation. Then we are doing serial to parallel because we are talking about OFDM. Then when we have the serial to parallel conversion, we are using this IAFT. Already we have discussed fast Fourier transform. Inverse fast Fourier transform we are doing at the transmitter. That's foundation to OFDM synthesis. Then we are adding cyclic prefix. We are adding extra cyclic prefix to take care of this frequency selective channel. And then finally, we are doing this windowing and filtering. Windowing and filtering, what we are doing? Because whenever we are transmitting, we should ensure that our transmission is not overlapping with other transmission, right? So not overlap. So we need to filter it. So I have shown in the bottom, just observe the bottom slide. So what is IAFT? So data transmitted via closely spaced narrow band subcarriers. So IAFT operation ensures subcarriers do not interfere with each other. Very, very important point. So what we are doing, data transmitted via closely spaced narrow band subcarriers, right? And we have seen that due to this IAFT, value, and then we take this.
अमित सर हेलो सर
हेलो हेलो
सर का सर यस सर की अमित सर आवाज नहीं आ रही सर की
नहीं सर, आवाज नहीं आई सर अभी। उनका
और
लेफ्ट हुआ था नाम का।
हाँ हाँ यस 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 जस्ट जस्ट वी आर वेटिंग 22nd स्लाइड था ना सर
यस सर, 22nd स्लाइड ओएपीएम।
ओएफटी हेलो प्रीतम सर
आई थिंक सर ऑडिबल नहीं हो पा रहे हो।
वो सर सर को हमको लगता है हमारी आवाज नहीं सुन
विवेक
सर सर यस सर यस सर नाउ यू आर
यस
ऑडिबल
यस
बीच
पता नहीं क्या हो गया बीच में।
में
एनीवे
कनेक्शन सर सर यस
सो दिस स्लाइड इज विजिबल 22nd स्लाइड
सर नॉट राइट नाउ सर
Not is visible.
सर यस स्लाइड इज कमिंग सर सर यस सर 22nd स्लाइड इज विजिबल सर इट इज 21st स्लाइड यस नाउ 22nd इज विजिबल सर
So this I ask all of you students particularly to take this this diagram, this understand this diagram very properly. This is the basic blocks what we use in practical systems in 4G standards, whether it is Wi-Fi or LTE. So what we are doing, that we have data, then we are doing scoring and modulation, then we are doing the serial to parallel, and then we are implementing IIFT, which is for OFDM, then we are adding cyclic prefix, then we are doing windowing filtering. So we were at this windowing.
हेलो विवेक सर,
यस सर यस
वॉइस नॉट ऑडिबल सर एक्चुअली,
इवन स्लाइड इज स्लाइड नहीं
सॉरी सर।
अभी है
ग्रेट
वो नेटवर्क का इशू है
सर,
कोई बात
यस यस नॉलेज ज्वाइनिंग सर।
विवेक
यस सर यस सर यस सर
क्या हो जाए, आई डोंट नो व्हाट इज प्रॉब्लम, आई डोंट
सर
लेट मी स्लाइड इज नॉट विजिबल ना।
नो नो सर ओनली सर योर वॉइस इज कमिंग सर।
ओके लेट लेट मी सर। क्लियर है, दिख रहा है आप?
यस सर, यस सर। नाउ इट इज 23rd स्लाइड सर, OFDM एडवांटेज डिसएडवांटेज।
So, now we'll discuss about this advantage of OFDM and advantage of OFDM, right? So, whatever we have discussed till now about this till slide 22nd. So we'll discuss now about advantage of OFDM. So now we can easily say that with confidence, we can say confidently that OFDM is especially efficient, robust in multipath environments, coexistence with current and future systems, and simple equalizer, right? Because we are taking care of inter-symbol interference, so we need a simple equalizer. So these are advantages, but there are always some disadvantage, right? It is not that we will get all the advantages all the time. So this highly sensitive to inter-channel interference, sensitive to frequency, clock, and phase offset. And then again, a big problem in time domain is that it has a relatively large peak to power, PAPR, peak to average power ratio. So these are a few disadvantages. A lot of research is going on in this area to take care of this offset and PAPR, right? So these are some research challenges in OFDM. But now we can observe that visible,
sir. It is visible.
Now just see the applications of OFDM. See, OFDM is used everywhere. It is everywhere. Like standards in IEEE 802.11ag, and these are the standards for Wi-Fi, your wireless LAN. 802.16a, and then 802.20 wideband, ultra wideband communication. Even in wireline communication, that is fixed communication, this ADSL. Asymmetric digital subscriber line, they are using OFDM. Then in mobile and radio, it is used in digital audio broadcasting, digital video broadcasting. It is used in hyperlan, it is used in WiMAX, it is used in physical layer architecture for 3GPP, and it is being used in 4G. And for your kind of information, it is a technology for 5G also, right? Now we'll move to fifth generation, right? It's all about understanding the 4G, which is a building block for 5G. We have understood that. Now we'll just discuss some of the challenges of this one, 5G. And just see that's what 5G basically means, right? So this slide will give you some idea that what 5G is all about, right? So the first point is that what the data rate is expected in 5G? So these are challenges basically. We need 1 to 10 Gbps data rate in real network, right? So in 4G, we were around 100 Mbps. 4G, we were around 100 Mbps. We are demanding 10 times more than that, minimum 10 times more than that. So this is journey from 100 Mbps to 1 Gbps. But now you can imagine that this journey is not so smooth. 10 times increase in data rate. Whether OFDM is still helpful? Yes. 1 millisecond round trip latency. It means that when we are transmitting some signal and we are receiving back, the round trip latency, the total time taken by the transmission to reception should be 1 millisecond. This is very, very tough requirement. High bandwidth in unit area, enormous number of connected devices, almost 100% coverage for any time, anywhere connectivity, reduction in energy usage by almost 90%, low power consumption. These are challenges. Now, in the right side, I have shown you that I have quantified it, right? This is all, the challenges, and I am just trying to put the number to these challenges. Now, in 5G, what we can expect compared to 4G and 3G, 10,000 times more traffic. Traffic is going to increase by 10,000 times. Number of devices will be 10 to 100 times more. So connected devices will be 10 to 100 times more. Latency already we have discussed in millisecond. Now battery life, you see, 10 years battery for machine-to-machine communication. So there are a lot of IoT, Internet of Things, you must be knowing that there are a lot of machine-to-machine communication. And there we want the battery life should be 10 years. And this machine-to-machine communication should be ultra low cost. We should get a data rate of 10 Gbps and worst case is 100 Mbps. For low-end data rates, what is the highest data rate in 4G? For low-end data rates, we are fixing 100 Mbps. Otherwise, 10 Mbps. And finally, it should be ultra reliable. It is not like that when you are there are 10,000 times more traffic, 100 times more devices, latency is very less, data rate is very high. So we can compromise on the reliability of transmission. It should be ultra reliable. These are the challenges. I will just tell you one of the challenges, I will just elaborate to you one of the challenges of 5G. So what we want 1 millisecond latency. Now LTE, that is a 4G technique, the latency is 10 milliseconds. How we can justify that? Because whatever mobile devices we are using, it has typically a latency of minimum 4 milliseconds is required to do all this processing in the mobile handset, like coding and modulation, IFT, windowing, cyclic prefix, everything required. Then RF power, then this baseband signal is converted to RF signal. Whatever we are transmitting, as an electromagnetic wave. So total minimum time required is 4 milliseconds. Then we have BTS, 4 milliseconds. Then we have core network, then internet, if in the same country as the customer, right? Otherwise we need to have a gateway. So minimum time requirement for LTE is 10 milliseconds. Now in 5G, what we want? We want less than 1 millisecond. It means that the processing in mobile should be done in less than 0.5 millisecond. And everything, this mobile and everything should be done in 0.5 millisecond, less than 0.5 millisecond. Now we can understand the stringent toughness, the challenge of 5G. Till date, we are not able to get a latency of 1 millisecond. We are somehow around 4 to 5 milliseconds. Right now, we are able to reduce the latency from 10 milliseconds to 4 to 5 milliseconds. But still, 1 millisecond is not possible. You may feel that, sir, why this round trip delay should be less than 1 millisecond? What is so important in that? Is it required? Yes, it is required. And I'll show you the next slide. Really, we need a latency of in the order of milliseconds. This is an important slide. So this is, I'm talking about wireless 2020 and beyond, right? This is a slide on what are the services you require and what are the challenges, right? So just concentrate on the right-hand side, right? Just concentrate on the right-hand side. This, the first services, right, is enhanced mobile broadband. So basically most of the users, what we are using is a mobile broadband. We want our mobile handset should be getting high speed connection, right? So this is termed as enhanced mobile broadband. Even we are moving our mobile handset, our laptop, our PDA, this should be able to support enhanced mobile broadband services. What are the requirements? What are the challenges? Very high data rate, high spectral efficiency, high mobility, low PAPR in uplink. PAPR is again the challenge in the OFDM, peak to average power ratio. That's why in uplink we are not using OFDM. We are downlink, we are using OFDM. In uplink, we are using single carrier FDMA. Simplified receiver design, right? It is not like that. If you are enhancing the services, you are giving this high mobility service, so your receiver will be complex. But at the same time, what you have to see that we are getting enhanced services, but at the same time, the receiver should be a simpler, simplified receiver design, and finally high densities. Because every mobile user have multiple connections now. Now it is very good in India also that even a chai wala, even a rickshaw puller, they all have this smartphone with them, right? So the high density we are getting, and even one user, one have multiple handset, even with one handset we have multiple connections. So the enhanced mobile broadband services we should give with high densities also. So this is all about we are very familiar with, but there are two other services which is very emergent in 4G and 5G is the massive machine type communication, right? Machine to machine communication is very important, right? In nowadays 2020 and beyond, machine to machine communication is very important. That's why other services which is required is massive machine type communication, and in that first category, the left side is IoT, Internet of Things, right? And what are challenges in Internet of Things? They should not be orthogonal. We are talking about OFDM, but we is basically here we need non-orthogonal transmission. High spectral efficiency is requirement everywhere. Low complexity is requirement, low PAPR is requirement, and this machine to machine communication is mostly asynchronous transmission because different machines are involved and they will transmit at any time. So you cannot have a synchronous transmission. They can transmit at any time, they can be at any locations, right? So we say that anytime, anywhere, so they can be situated at any position and they can transmit at any time. So the transmission will be asynchronous, it cannot be synchronous transmission. Minimum OOB, out of band transmission. So we have discussed that we are using this windowing and filtering we are doing in OFDM in 4G to reduce this out of band emission. So minimum OOB because there are multiple devices. And I have just given you an example. What are examples of IoT? Sensor network for smart grid. Smart grid, right? We are making our grid smart. So since we are using a lot of sensors there, that is a part of this IoT, then cities, sensor network for cities and homes, then intelligent transport systems, they all are using sensors. They are making a Internet of Things and they require this type of services. One of the applications of massive machine type communication is IoT. And examples are intelligent transport systems, smart grids, smart cities, and smart homes. They come under the application of IoT. There are multiple other applications also, smart industry. There are so many things, but for your information, that these are two intelligent transport systems are good example. Now, the middle one, where you are talking about ultra reliable and low latency services. Ultra reliable. Reliability should be 99.99. Low latency said latency should be in terms of a few milliseconds. Do we need that? Yes. And one other example is autonomous self-driving vehicle, autonomous vehicle, unmanned vehicle. Other words, we say that unmanned automatic vehicle, UAV, unmanned autonomous vehicle. There, we don't have driver, the driverless car. Other example is driverless car, right? So there, you cannot afford if you are not using a driver, a vehicle is moving, you need it to be ultra reliable, otherwise there will be a lot of accidents. And the response time of that system, whatever intelligence systems we are using, machines we are using, should be very less. Like we are driving, our response time is in terms of few milliseconds. Then only we can avoid accidents on the road. We have to take decision fractions of second, right? Then other application is tactile radio or tactile internet. So what we need here, sub millisecond latency is very important here. Immune to Doppler. Very Doppler is what? We all know that whenever there is a little motion between transmitter and receiver, the receive frequency changes, right? And that receive frequency change will create another type of problem in the wireless communication that I have not discussed. Whenever there is a little motion between transmitter and receiver, the channel become time varying. Right, or in other words, receive frequency changes. So if you're transmitting at 1 megahertz, you will receive signal at 1.006 megahertz, right? So your receiver will not be able to synchronize, right? So there will be offset, frequency offset, receive frequency offset, and this will lead that your receiver is not orthogonal now, the delta F, but we maintain an OFDM to be orthogonal, right? One by TF, so they are not orthogonal. Whenever there is frequency shift, they will not be orthogonal. And at the same time, it should be low complexity. Complexity is always at a low, in the low complexity is the requirement for the all the services, right? Now I will just give you some idea about how 5G is being developed, right? How 5G is evolved. So this dual track for 5G. One track will be of evolution, where we are using this 4G. We are enhancing this 4G to get 5G, and other will be totally a new technology. So first point is that evolution of LTE Advanced will continue. So LTE Advanced is basically we are evolving LTE to LTE Advanced to 5G. So evolution of LTE Advanced will continue beyond in a backward compatible manner with the goal of improving system performance in the bands below 6 GHz. So what we are trying to do is that whatever LTE we have developed, LTE 4G is around 2 GHz. So what we are trying to see that we are improving this LTE up to 6 GHz. We are adding some more technologies and we are seeing that we get this enhanced services and we are able to increase the data rate in 1 gigabits per second range, and we should be able to implement 5G. So, but this evolution of 4G to 5G using this LTE Advanced is backward compatible. It means that if you 5G services you are not able to get, you will get 4G services. If not 4G, you will be able to get 3G services, right? The second point is very important. It is also expected that at least a part of 5G requirements can be met by the continued evolution of LTE Advanced. It means that some part of 5G requirements will be met by LTE, by evolving LTE, right? So from 4G, we will enhance 4G further to LTE Advanced to see that we are able to get 5G. And that services we are aiming around 6 GHz. This is very important. We are not trying beyond 6 GHz. The second track is commonly known as the new radio access technology track in 3GPP, which is not limited for backward compatibility requirements. So this new track, new radio access, RAT means radio access technology. We are talking about new radio access technology. They are not backward compatible. So if when you are using new radio access technology, and you are using 5G services, you will not be able to get 4G and 3G services on that. Keep that in mind. Because this will be totally a new technology. So again, I will read this line. The second track is commonly known as a new radio access technology track in 3GPP, which is not limited by backward compatibility requirements and can integrate breakthrough technologies to achieve the best possible performance. We are talking about now breakthrough technologies. Totally a new technology which has never heard in 4G. So key technologies. So first is when we are going from LTE Advanced, evolution from LTE Advanced. That is, we are giving 5G services around 6 GHz. To implement that, what are new technologies we require? One is software-defined networking, right? So this is one important technology which is required to implement 5G around 6 GHz. So what is software-defined networking? Utilizes the resources efficiently using software-defined networking to serve a large number of devices. Because in 5G, there are a lot of devices. So what we need to implement services using software. It is not possible always to change the hardware. See, to get new services, to add more users, you can add more hardware. What you need to do, you just change the software and you get to add more users, you should be able to get more services. And that's all about software-defined networking. We are giving services, we are adding new users using this software-defined networking. Then you are talking about full-dimensional MIMO, right? The second technology, full-dimensional MIMO, what is that? Utilizes a large number of antennas placed in a two-dimensional, that's 2D antenna array panel to form narrow beams in both the horizontal and vertical directions. In 4G, what we are doing, we are only transmitting either in the horizontal direction or vertical direction using MIMO, multiple antennas, as a transmitter or receiver. But in 5G, we have to transmit in two dimensions, both in horizontal as well as in the vertical. And that's why the name is called full dimensional MIMO. So improving the system performance by realizing high order multi-user multiplexing, because we are transmitting. So what it does, improving the system performance by realizing high order multi-user multiplexing. And the last point is that significantly improves beamforming and spatial user multiplexing capacity. Just for your information, beamforming is an important technique, and we are able to implement that using the full dimensional MIMO. Some of the terms you will not be able to understand. Don't worry for that. Just go through some standard textbooks, go through some standard research papers. You will be able to understand what do you mean by beamforming and what do you mean by spatial user multiplexing, right? Because we are using antennas both in horizontal and vertical directions. So we will be able to transmit more data. We are able to transmit at a higher data rate, right? And we can serve more users. Everything is possible with full dimensional MIMO. Another important technique is licensed assisted access, LAA, using LTE, right? This is another important technique. What is that? The use of unlicensed spectrum. We know that there are a lot of unlicensed spectrum. The use of unlicensed spectrum is now being considered as a potential complement to LTE system operating in licensed spectrum. So we have a licensed spectrum as well as unlicensed spectrum. So we have used now unlicensed spectrum also. So it will now complement. So again, I will read this line. The use of unlicensed spectrum is now being considered as a potential complement to LTE systems operating licensed spectrum. Second point. Moreover, first, using the underutilized resources LTE is an active research. Third point, LAA, license assistance access, is expected to improve the utilization efficiency of unlicensed spectrum and licensed spectrum both. So LAA is one of the techniques. Just for your information, you can find more information in the literature. Right? So another important technique is NOMA, non-orthogonal multiple access. We have seen that when we are talking about IoT, orthogonal techniques are not going to help us. So why we need non-orthogonal multiple access? Increases capacity by multiplexing users to same resources at the transmitter and separating them with the system difference cancellation at the receiver. So if we are free from this orthogonal conditions, we can add more users, right? Then another important technique is green communication. This is very, very important. Low power consumption and less. Huh?
Sir, we are at 38 slides. Sir.
Yes, 38 I'm talking about.
37 slides, sir. Dikh raha hai aap.
38 is not visible? Oh, sorry.
No, sir. Yes. Now it is visible. Yes.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So,
it is visible.
We are talking about NOMA. NOMA is important for IoT application. Internet of Things application, NOMA is important. Because what it does is, because these are massive devices. If you keep your transmitter orthogonal, you have always this condition. That orthogonal to maintain. Then how you will be able to add more users, which are asynchronous, which are placed at different locations, which can transmit at any time? Not possible. So we are talking about non-orthogonal multiple access, NOMA. And here what we are doing is, we are just adding n number of users. There will be interference. Let there be interference, and that interference will be removed at the receiver. That's why I'm writing increase capacity by multiplexing users to same resource. Let it be same resource, right? Like in case of OFDM, the resources are orthogonal. But here, we are transmitting the same resource at the transmitter, and let there be interference. And we will remove that interference using the successive interference cancellation, right? Then coming to green communication, because we have tremendous number of devices, the device connection is increased by 100 times. So So what we have to see that there are a lot of electromotive wave, there are a lot of carbon footprint, there are a lot of signal processing. So we talk about low power consumption and less carbon footprint to the nature. Very important. Very, very important. Otherwise, the systems, what we are developing in 5G, they are not environment friendly. To make them environment friendly, there's low power consumption and less carbon footprints. And there are three important other techniques, carrier aggregation enhancement, where we are aggregating different subcarriers. Then we have basin type communication, wireless security. So security is also important in terms of 5G, right? Security is always important, whether you're talking about 3G, 4G and 5G. But because number of devices increased tremendously, number of services has increased manifold, so we have to see that our transmission is secure. Now, these are the few technologies for new radio access technologies, right? New radio access. This is totally a new technology, which is not, we are not implementing 4G or LTE Advanced, right? So one of techniques out of this five, I will discuss about Massive MIMO. Just see this base station. What we are talking about, Massive MIMO. There is not 3, 4, 10, or 20 antennas. There are hundreds of antennas, right? You just see that we have, these are our antennas. We can think of antennas, more 100 antennas in one transmitter. Then we are talking about millimeter wave. Just see this right hand side, this plot, spectrum plot. What we can observe here is that 6 GHz is fine. 6 GHz, up to 6 GHz, we are enhancing the services, right? From 4G to 4G advanced, and we are getting 5G. This one spectrum. So around 6 GHz, right? We are in as 4G. The other is from 24 GHz to 100 GHz. So your lambda, the wavelength of transmission, the wavelength of electromagnetic wave will be now in millimeter, right? And that's why we say that millimeter wave bandwidth. Now what we are trying to do is that we are trying to design transmitter and receivers, we are trying to design signal processing, we are trying to design the hardware in the range of frequencies more than 24 GHz. 24 GHz means that you are in millimeter wave, lambda is millimeter wave. The total design will change. The hardware will change, signal processing will change, antennas will change. The totally is a new technology. This technology is never heard in 4G, right? So that's why whenever we are developing a device in this beyond 24 GHz band, they will not be able to give you services of 4G, that is around 6 GHz, right? So these two technologies are the main propellant of 5G, and that comes under new radio system. That's why the name we use is a new radio access technology. One is Massive MIMO and other is millimeter wave, right? Now, advantage is that these are two technologies, totally new technologies, which is not there in 4G or 4G advanced, LTE advanced. This Massive MIMO, where we have hundreds of antenna in horizontal and vertical direction, in different layers, different planes, I can say, different planes. In one plane, we have horizontal and vertical antennas, and we have different planes. So we are talking about Massive MIMO, and then we are talking about millimeter wave. Now, best part is that why Massive MIMO at millimeter wave frequency? Because these two technologies are going to help you at millimeter waves, that is beyond 24 gigahertz. One advantage is that why you are talking about 24 gigahertz and beyond? Because when you are moving higher in the frequency band, there will be more bandwidth. We have more bandwidth, like optical communication. What is happening there? We are transmitting at the optical frequency band, and optical frequency band has huge bandwidth. So if you are moving 24 gigahertz in wireless communication, we have huge bandwidth. That's the first line, is that large available bandwidth at millimeter wave, right? So when you are at 300 megahertz, lambda is 1 meter. Just see, I'm just finding you. Just see this yellow patch, yellow frequency band. When lambda is, so when frequency 300 megahertz, lambda is 1 meter. When frequency is 3 gigahertz, lambda is 100 meter. And when the frequency is 30 gigahertz, your lambda is 10 millimeter, right? So you are in a millimeter band. And we are talking about 100 gigahertz spectrum in millimeter wave bands, right? So when you come to 3 gigahertz, your lambda will be 1 millimeter, right? Up to that, we are considering. So we have a huge bandwidth available. Now, what will happen that there will high path, the biggest problem with millimeter wave is that path loss will be very, very high. When we are moving higher in the frequency band, the path loss will be very high, right? So that's why the second point, high path loss due to antenna aperture size and atmospheric absorption. When we are transmitting this millimeter wave using these antennas, and there will be a lot of absorption in the atmosphere, all these droplets, water droplets and all, scintillating effects, they all will absorb your signal transmission. So the power, you cannot transmit at a longer distance. The biggest problem with millimeter wave is that you cannot transmit more than 10 meters, right? So what we are doing, we are trying to implement this millimeter wave with massive MIMO. By the help of massive MIMO and millimeter wave, what we are trying to do, that path loss can be mitigated by using high gain directional antennas. So what we are using directional antennas, millimeter wave, and we are able to take care of this high path loss at millimeter wave. So what is good point is that massive MIMO resolves millimeter wave issues. That's why I've given it. Just see the heading there, massive MIMO resolves millimeter wave issue. Because millimeter is that there is a lot of path loss. You're going to transmit millimeter wave of frequency of more than 24 gigahertz to a larger distance. What we are using? We are using this massive MIMO. And this massive MIMO is what you just see, this antenna, that when you are using antenna propagation pattern, we have main lobe, then we have two side lobes, and using multiple antennas, we can use this beam forming technique, and we can have high gain directional antennas to transmit your signal, right? So we can extend the coverage of millimeter wave, right? And finally, this is the last slide. Where I'm just talking about the Vision 5G from industrial and research perspective. For Ericsson, Qualcomm, they are the world leaders in 5G communication. Docomo, Nokia Solution Networks, 5G now, and they are defining 5G in different way. They have different visions for 5G. What Ericsson said, network society, affordable and sustainable. Qualcomm vision is that enabling novel services, connecting industries and devices, improved user experience. Docomo, which is Japanese tech company, 5G, everything connected wirelessly. Nokia solutions, headnets, augmented reality, and tactile internet. For 5GGP, Matas, EU, software-driven 5G, scalable and sustainable, 5G now, unified framework, Amazon synchronization, and non-orthogonal multiplexes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We will be having a small query session. So for that, I would like to invite Amit sir to kindly present the question asked by student to respected sir.
Thank you, Vivek sir, and thank you, Pritam sir. That was a very nice presentation, sir, about the fifth generation. And the questions raised by student is like...
Can you be louder, please? I'm not able to...
Okay, sir. I was saying about, is there any difference in OFDM and OFDMA?
Yes, good question. OFDM, orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, right? OFDM is meant for single user, right? There is only one single user and transmitter and user receiver. When there is single user, we use the term OFDM. But when we are using this technology for multiple users, orthogonal frequency division multiple access, MA, if OFDM, M stands for multiplexing, orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. OFDM is orthogonal frequency division multiple access. When we are using this OFDM for multiple users, then this is termed as OFDMA. Right? Multiple use concept is OFDMA. Okay. That's why OFDMA is technology for 4G, for multiple users.
Okay, sir. And one more question is like about the 2.5 generation, that's all the A's. And what is the maximum data rate for that, sir?
Pardon?
What is the maximum data rate for
2.5?
Sir, what is the maximum data rate for 2.5 generation, sir? Is that for the age? Age ke liye sabse zyada maximum data rate kitna ho sakta hai, sir, usme?
See, edge and this GPRS, these two are technologies of 2.5G. Maximum what you can get is 100 kbps you will get.
Okay, sir. And which technique we are using in edge?
That is CDMA and TDMA, both. Mix of CDMA and TDMA.
Both.
Mostly it is a TDMA technology, and some part of CDMA we are using to increase the data rate.
Another question from a student is like, sir, what is the operating frequency for LTE band? Almost, they are asking.
Then what is the operating frequency of?
LTE, the fourth generation, sir, 4G ke liye.
Achha, LTE, good question. Yes, so yes. LTE is around 2.4 gigahertz, right? So what is happening, different countries are following different frequency bands. The India, whatever band we are taking for LTE is different from what we are following in USA. So USA, America, we have different bands. But in general, the frequency bands is around 2.4 gigahertz.
Yes, sir. Actually, sir, I am also a researcher scholar, sir. So I'm also working on the fifth generation communication. I'm working in antenna domain, sir. So
antenna domain, okay.
Yes, sir. So I have some queries regarding my research. Like I'm also forming an antenna for the beam forming kind of. Okay, sir. But I'm not clearing my things for which frequency I'm designing, in case we are designing for India, sir. So because 28 gigahertz is defined worldwide, somewhere we can say 24 gigahertz also considered. But for, if you're talking about India ki case, if I look at which frequency we can operate.
Best, Amit, you concentrate right now on 6 gigahertz, around 6 gigahertz, right?
Okay, sir. Okay, see, sir. 6 gigahertz.
Because this millimeter wave and all, they have their own challenges. I don't know how much time it will take to saturate.
Yes, sir. Yes,
so
sir.
What you are hearing in media that 5G they have implemented, everything is being implemented around 6 gigahertz, right? And they are just trying to evolve from 4G LTE advanced, and then better you concentrate on around 6 gigahertz, like in Wi-Fi 6. Wi-Fi 6 you might have heard. So Wi-Fi 6 is that.
But sir, at a low frequency, there are some challenges occur, like we are not able to form a beam much narrower, sir. But the high frequency we can go easily for the narrow beam, sir.
Yeah, that is true. But see, millimeter wave you can go, but problem is that again for fabrication, for other testing.
Yes,
and all.
Yes, you are correct, sir. Yes, sir. From the fabrication point of view, that is very tough for me, sir.
Better if you 6 gigahertz, even 10 gigahertz, if you are doing fine. Ultra wideband also it is good.
Okay, sir. Thank you for this, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Vivek, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Pritam sir, I would like to convey that we are having a listener from all the branches. We are having more than 250 students on YouTube and around 170 students on Facebook listening to the this webinar. Considering the importance of 5G communication these days, the webinar is really conveying. And on behalf of Government Engineering College, Vaishali, I would like thank you, respected sir, for accepting our invitation and for thank giving you. Your talk, sir. The talk is, sir, saved in YouTube, so our students can watch the talk anytime. Okay. So yes, sir.
Thank you. The problem is that I have to see that the students are there, first year, second year, third year. So I cannot be very technical. At the same time, I have to see that the students are able to, I'm able to sensitize them to learn new things and give some extra effort, trying to understand this different technologies of 4G and 5G. Because in fact, this almost 1.5 hour session we started.
Yes, sir.
And you can tell your students, if they have any doubt, you can write a mail to me. They can connect to me anytime, and if in whatsoever possible way, I will be able to help them, right?
Yes, sir. Sir, from past 1 week, the students were very excited because 5G is by the name 5G. Student wants to know about the basics of 5G. Even from a civil domain student, they called me and they asked what will be the timing of the workshop. That particular thing is showing their interest toward the new technology. So thank you so much, sir. So with your permission, sir, we would like to end the session. And in the last, I would like to thank you again, you sir. And thank you all the listeners, all my dear students, to join the session. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, may we please end the session, sir?
Yes, Vivek, just say the YouTube that link. I will also like
Sure. I will share the YouTube link to your mail, sir.
Okay.
And sure. Facebook link as well, sir. Facebook link as well. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, respected.